म्यूट हो गया तो
नहीं क्रॉस था ना, ठीक है म्यूट है, दोबारा करके देखते।
स्टार्ट नहीं हुआ।
हेलो जी, म्यूट पे करो।
म्यूट पे किया।
बता रहा कि म्यूट पे प्रेस करो, आप तो म्यूट नहीं हो
आई रिक्वेस्ट द पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू स्टे म्यूटेड प्लीज। Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Grand Rounds for the 1st of May. And today we have with us the Department of Psychiatry and Clinical Psychology. They are going to talk to us about adolescent mental health, which is a very important and probably a very tricky topic. We all know that it's difficult to take care of adolescents at home. So taking care of adolescents with mental health disorders, I'm sure, is much more difficult. So we have today with us the HOD of Department of Psychiatry, Dr. Mamta Singla, and we also have with us Dr. Nidhi Agarwal, who is the clinical psychologist. And I'll hand over the mic to Dr. Mamta and you can start.
Thank you, ma'am. Screen share. So, good morning, everybody. Today's grand round topic is adolescent mental health issues. Here in this presentation, first we'll define what is a normal mental health, like how we define the mental health among adolescents, and what are the various adolescent mental health issues, and how we can have appropriate prevention regarding that. As with physical health, mental health is not merely the absence of disease or a mental health disorder. It includes emotional well-being, psychological well-being, and social well-being. A mentally healthy person is competent enough to navigate successfully the complexities of life. So there are certain skills which determine positive mental health, like learning to manage emotions. Suppose the person has utilized appropriate coping mechanism to achieve, if they have used their appropriate coping mechanism, they can have their well-being in stressful situations. And having good interpersonal skills, it means they are able to develop fulfilling relationships. And they have developed appropriate coping and problem-solving skills. So they are resilient in the face of stress, and they have realized their potential and their needs. And if they have adopted their healthy sleep pattern and healthy lifestyle, and they are flexible enough in the stress, and they can adapt in these stressful states, so it means they are mentally healthy, and they have acquired these skills in a socially and emotionally competent way. They are self-efficacious, and they have high self-esteem and positive self-identity. Coming to prevalence, India is the second most populous country in the world with a population of 1.236 billion. In this vast population, every fifth person is an adolescent between 10 and 19 years, and every third person is aged between 10 and 24 years. There are more than 434 million children and adolescents in India, which is the highest in the world. And half of all mental conditions, they start by 14 years of age, and also an estimated that is 10 to 20% of adolescents globally experience mental health conditions. Yet most cases are undetected and untreated. All human beings have basic needs in addition to food and water. These basic needs are need to belong, need to feel powerful, need to have enjoyment, and need to have independence. Belonging means feeling like a part of something or being accepted or being included or sense of fitting into your relationships or into your friends. And so if this need is not fulfilled, it can create anxiety, it creates depression among the individuals. Need to powerful means it means they are able to make their own decisions. They are independent. They have needs to have enjoyment means they have fun seeking or thrill seeking behavior in this age group. And need to have independence means all about having control over one's life, being autonomous. So raising teenagers or adolescents means being attuned to all basic needs of humans, which are even stronger during adolescence. If we define it, it is a transitional age of physical and psychological human development, generally occurring during the period from puberty to legal adulthood. And this is particularly vulnerable period as a lot of mental, emotional and social changes occurs through puberty. Coming to stages of adolescent. Early adolescent means 10 to 13 years, mid adolescent 14 to 16 years, and late adolescent 17 to 19 years. In early adolescent, here puberty has commenced. So they are curious for sex, for their appearance. They need privacy, and they have more inclination towards their friends rather than parents. And here think is self-centered, means egocentric thinking is there. They think either the things are right or wrong. I mean, they have concrete thinking here. Abstract thinking has not started well here. And here, because they are more inclined, attention has started towards their friends. So control by parents or restriction by parents, they react to those things. They need privacy here. There is a curiosity for sex, but although they don't indulge actively in sexual relationships. In mid-adolescent, poverty-related changes continue here. And so there is an increased interest in romantic and sexual activities like masturbation and relationships. And there is a strong desire for independence. Here, they don't want to get controlled by their parents, by their family. And so whenever restrictions are imposed upon, they react, they argue. And there is a peer pressure is high in this age group. And there occur maturation of brain and thought process parallelly. But the emotions and cognitive thinking, they don't go hand in hand. They don't go parallelly. There is a disparity in emotions and cognitive development here. You can say that in puberty, brain start developing and strengthening those parts that allow them to feel intense and complex emotions like limbic system. But the part of brain that is responsible for regulating emotions, deep thinking, reasoning, and for consequences is often last to develop, that is prefrontal cortex. So children feel like their emotions out of control as they may not have the mental capacity to cope with them just yet and causing even more irritation and frustration here. As frontal play a big role in coordinating complex decision-making, impulse control, and being able to consider multiple actions and consequences. So although abstract thinking develop, but they still lack the ability to stay in the moment, as there is a disparity in emotions and cognition. So let me explain you through some examples. I'm doing well enough in math, and I really want to see this movie. So one night of skipping studies won't matter. Do I really have to wear a condom during sex if my girlfriend takes the birth pills? And marijuana is legal now, so it not be that bad. So while they may be able to think logically, strong emotions often continue to drive their decisions when impulses come into play. In late adolescent, there occur complete physical development, sexual development. There is a more mature impulse control. They are responsible in their relationships, during decisions, in their jobs. And here, there is a strong sense of self-identity. Their values and beliefs solidify. And there occur re-establishment of relationship with parents. They get emotionally and physically separate from their parents. But at the same time, there is a re-establishment of relationship. Means they don't think them as an authority, rather think them as a parallel, maybe as a friends or maybe mature adults whom with they can share their decisions, their whatever their desires, whatever they are going in their life, they can share with them as a parallel. I mean, they think them as a parallel. So, like, suppose I explain you through these examples. While I do love older movies, I need to study for my finals. I should wear a condom, even though my girlfriend is on birth control, and that's not 100% in preventing pregnancy. Even though marijuana is legal, I'm worried about how it might affect my mood, my work, and school performance. So in late adolescence, they are able to better gauge between risk and reward. So if we summarize puberty, it's a journey through the physical, emotional, and social changes. And as the adolescent has to undergo through numerous challenges due to altered sleep-wake cycle, due to puberty, due to disparity between emotions and cognitive development, and emotional and social changes. So this makes them highly vulnerable for the situation. Coming to vulnerability of adolescent. This age group is quite vulnerable as there is a desire for greater autonomy. Or you can say that there is a strong craving for independence. Autonomy means rather than following others' belief, they think, they behave, and make moral decisions on their own way. And there is a pressure to conform with peers. So conformity here is to follow along with the behavior and opinion of friends. They rely more on their peers, and peer pressure increases as teens grow old. There is increased access to use of technology, and there is a lot of media influence. They are exploring their sexual identity. And on the top of that, if there is a poor quality of home life, means if the parents are in conflict and poor emotional support, or maybe they are overly criticizing and overly restricting and overly controlling, and suppose there is a mental illness in a family, this makes them highly vulnerable for developing mental health issues. So sadly, whenever young people, they cannot get those needs met safely through positive peer interaction, through deep they will often seek out negative ways to do it. Drug or gang involvement, risk-taking, bullying, or running away are all examples of how a teen might try to meet needs in an unsafe manner. They may develop high self-esteem issues. They may have mood swings. They may have body image issues. They may have identity crisis. They may go into anxiety. They may go into depression. So these things develop whenever these needs are not met in a healthy way. So promoting psychological well-being and protecting adolescent from adverse experiences and risk factors that may impact their potential to thrive are critical for their well-being and for their physical and mental health in adulthood. Coming to types of mental health disorders in adolescent. These are anxiety disorders, most common, then conduct disorder, depressive illnesses, addiction, eating disorders, along with schizophrenia and bipolar disorders. Conduct disorder. It's a mental disorder diagnosed in childhood and adolescent that represents a repetitive and persistent pattern of behavior in which the basic rights of others or major age-appropriate norms are violated. It's a severe condition characterized by hostile and sometimes physically violent behavior, and there is a severe disregard to authority and to the rules. They may be aggressive, they may be physically harmful to other animals or to other people, they may keep weapon with themselves, they may have lying behavior, I mean, they keep on lying for the sake of lying, they have stealing tendencies, they are destructive in their whenever they are suffering from conduct disorder, they may violate rules, and there is a disregard for rules, like they may skip school, they may run away from home, there is a history of substance use also, and they can indulge into sexual activities. So the kids having pushing, hitting, biting, it's normal in this conduct disorder. Coming to etiology, in the etiology, there can be environmental issues, the genetic and biological issues, there can be psychological reasons, and there can be social reasons. In the environmental reasons, first, there is a dysfunctional family, means parents are in conflict with each other, is a poor emotional support by the parents or the family, and maybe one of the parents is suffering from the mental illness, or there is a history of substance abuse, or there is a history of childhood abuse or child trauma, or maybe parents are over-controlling, over-critical. So these things, they make predispose for conduct disorder. And among the genetical and biological reasons, suppose there is a family history of mental illness, and the kids having biological parents having ADHD, alcohol dependence and depression, bipolar, they are more prone to develop conduct disorders. And suppose there is an injury to certain area of brain, like frontal lobe damage, there occur lack of impulse control, reduced ability to plan for future, and decreased ability to learn from the past consequences. And along with that, if there is a poor moral awareness with deficient in cognitive processing, and along with there is a in social poor here the low because is not is produced for developing conduct disorder. It should be addressed as early as possible. Coming to eating disorder. Eating disorder is most common in females, and it typically begins in the mid to late adolescent, and it is 10 times more frequent in women than, and average prevalence is about 0.5% in females. And it is characterized by excessive weight loss, and there is a refusal to maintain body weight above minimal weight level. And there is a starvation. And the patient, the individual, remains severely preoccupied with food. And there is a progressive restriction against whole category of food. There is an intense fear for about gaining fat or about gaining weight, even though they are underweight. And there is excessive denial of hunger. And there is a consistent excuse to avoid mealtime. And they have indulged themselves into excessive and rigid exercise regime, and they usually withdraw from their friends. And so there is an intense drive for thinness, and there is an extreme bodily dissatisfaction and feeling of ineffectiveness. So whenever we explore, whenever we view these patients, there is a distorted body image or negative body image. If we define healthy body image, means having an objective perception of one's appearance and an ability to separate one's values as a person from the way one looks. But these patients, they have high poor self-esteem and depression, and they feel inadequate. They have low opinion about themselves. They feel empty inside, and they usually remain dissatisfied and engage in behaviors such as diet, checking and avoidance. Anxiety disorders are the most common mental, emotional, and behavioral problem to occur in this age group, and girls are more affected than boys. Normally, anxiety is a general feeling of apprehension or worry, and it's a normal reaction to stressful situations. Reflex should go up when the feelings become excessive, thoughts become irrational, and everyday functioning is compromised. These are the types of anxiety disorders, like generalized anxiety disorder, PTSD, panic attacks, phobias, and OCDs. In generalized anxiety disorder, they remain worried for routine day-to-day activities. And so these anxiety interfere in their academic performance, in their social issues, and their family issues. In panic attacks, they feel attacks of anxiety, which are self-sustaining, but they feel like they are going to maybe getting suffocation, or maybe they are going to die, and they have all kind of anxiety symptoms like blurring of vision, or maybe dryness of mouth or chest, suffocation, and increased urination or increased stomach. So all these are intense attacks of anxiety in panic attacks. In phobias, they have severe irrational fear, intense fear of certain objects and certain situations, like agoraphobia, claustrophobia, neurophobias, misophobias. And in OCDs, they are having persistent, uncontrollable, irresistible thoughts, which they are not able to control. And they can be in the form of images, ideas, and obsessions they have to do again and again to decrease their anxiety. So they have to indulge in compulsive activities. So these are the most common anxiety disorders which occur in adolescent age group. And common presenting symptoms are agitation. They may feel restless. They may have anger issues. They may feel irritability. There is a history of weight loss or gain because their appetite changes. They feel fatigue. There is a loss of energy. They have sleep issues. They feel withdrawal, and there is a loss of interest in pleasurable activities. There is a drop in academic performance, and they may can indulge into legal issues. Coming to addictions in adolescent, and this is very relevant topic nowadays. Maybe this is related to some substance addiction, maybe related to internet, phone, and porn addiction, maybe related to alcohol addiction. So if we define it, it is a maladaptive pattern of substance use leading to clinically significant impairment and distress within a 12-month period. And if the individual is having recurrent substance use, resulting in failure to fulfill major role obligations at work, school, and home, and suppose they are using in spite of knowing that it is physically hazardous, and they have recurrent substance-related legal issues, and suppose they are using despite persistent and recurrent social and interpersonal problems, it means they are getting addicted and dependent on the substance. Adolescent and children, substance abuse can bring immediate and late onset devastating consequences. And so they can have alcohol-related motor vehicle accidents, remain leading cause of mortality among youth. They can share needles with each other. So IV drug use can lead to transmission of blood-borne viruses, and they may plunge into high-risk behavior like sexual risk-taking, sexual victimization, and unintentional injuries high in these cases. Coming to epidemiology, lifetime prevalence of substance use is 11.4%. And more than half of the adolescents report alcohol use, and 1/4 report exposure to illicit drugs. Prevalence rate of alcohol and drug dependence, like 1.3 and 1.8% respectively, are 1/4 the magnitude of abuse. In India, extent of pattern of substance abuse among children and adults is different, and it is uncommon among girls. And common drug abused in Indian adolescents are alcohol, tobacco, minor tranquilizers, analgesics, and cannabis. Coming to predisposing factors. So because this age group is quite vulnerable, they have exploring and risk-taking tendencies, and they have underlying so many issues. And so because drug promise quick relief and instant gratification, and maybe this is the way of escapism from the situation, and because drugs modify their unpleasant feelings, And because they also get group acceptance, and because drugs are easily available. And the, on the top of that, suppose there is a biological predisposition, means parents are into substance addiction or into one of mental illness, or maybe there is a negative family environment in the form of idolizing of the parents and using substance, or maybe conflict between parents, or poor emotional support by the parents and unavailability of the parents for the solving of their conflicts. And suppose there is an underlying personality traits. So these adolescents, they are more vulnerable for developing addiction. So whenever we have to look for, like, they are into addiction, suppose there is absenteeism from their school, from their academics, and suppose there is a change in behavior, means they're getting more irritable, isolated, aloof, and there is a change in academic performance. And suppose there is a problem in controlling mood and behavior, they're more irritable, negative, they react out, and there is a neglect of their physical appearance, their neglect of self-care, their neglect of their appetite, and suppose they have history of weight loss. And on physical examining, suppose there are bruises, needle marks, dilated pupil, and bloodshot eyes, then we can suspect that these adolescents, they are into substance addiction. On this background, we proceed with this presentation so that we can explore root causes in development of various disorders, identify high-risk group, and then have appropriate interventions for achieving their holistic health. Dr. Nidhi will take over now. Good morning, everybody. I am Dr. Nidhi Agarwal. I will take up the adolescent mental health psychological management part. Cognitive behavior therapy is a type of talk therapy which involves identifying and challenging unhelpful thoughts and helping people learn how to modify their thinking patterns and behavior to improve the way they feel. Cognitions are the thoughts, beliefs, and internal images that people have about events in their lives. Cognitive theories focus on mental processes and their influence on mental health. A common premise is that how people think largely determines how they feel and behave. Beck contends that people with emotional difficulties tend to commit characteristic logical errors that tilt objective reality in the direction of self-destruction. Cognitive therapy perceives psychological problems stemming from commonplace processes such as faulty thinking, making incorrect inferences on the basis of inadequate or incorrect information, and failing to distinguish between fantasy and reality. Cognitive therapy is a focused form of psychotherapy and a model stipulating that psychiatric disorders involve dysfunctional thinking. Dysfunctional or distorted thinking arises from both biological and psychological influences. Individuals' emotional behavior, physiological reaction are all influenced by the way they structure their environment. In any given situation, the thought, the emotion, the physical reaction, and the behavior are interconnected. Modifying these cognitive thoughts and the dysfunctional thought and the behavior lead to improvement in symptoms. If modification of the dysfunctional beliefs which underlie the dysfunctional thinking lead to more durable improvement. The cognition, it affects how the feeling is interpreted, and the feeling in relation affects our behavior. So the thoughts create the feeling. The feelings in turn influence the behavior, and the behavior then is reinforced by the thought again. This is a vicious circle and they are cyclic in nature. So if any of the three is affected, all three get affected. Thought is what we think after. It affects how we feel and act. Behavior, what we do affects how we think and feel about it. Emotion would be what we feel, it affects how we think and act. And this is cyclic in nature. So we can say that behavior is secondary to thinking. If I think I am not good and the negativity is there, I may behave in a different manner. Let's take an example. In case I have invited a friend for dinner and she is late, based on that, I can think several aspects. If I think that she might have been hurt on her way, I may be worried about, I may be anxious about her well-being, and I can call up hospital her to know about her whereabouts, her family and her friends. So in that case, I am worried about her, I'm anxious about her. I think that she didn't bother to let me know and she was delayed. I may be annoyed with her. Corresponding to that, my behavior would be changed. I may be rude to her when she comes to me. The other possibility is that it didn't matter to me whether we are late or on time. So I may have an indifferent attitude. And in that case, I may feel nothing in particular about the situation. Yet another scenario would be that I think that I need time to fix the house up anyway. So I'm very relaxed within and I have a relaxed attitude to her when she is there, and I'll be very welcoming to her even despite the fact that she was late. So the thought influences the feeling and the corresponding behavior. The rationale of negative emotions are elicited by cognitive processes developed through influence of learning and temperament. Adverse life events elicit automatic processing, which is viewed as the cognitive factor. Now, the cognitive triad would include ourselves, others, and the future. The negative automatic thoughts center around our understanding of these three parameters. The CBT focuses on examination of cognitive beliefs and developing rational response to negative automatic thoughts. Distorted appraisal follows themes relevant to the specific psychiatric condition. Psychological disorders are characterized by a different psychological profile. For example, in depression, negative view of self, others, and future does exist. Poor beliefs associated with helplessness, failure, incompetence, and unlovability are present. Whereas in anxiety, overestimation of physical and psychological threats are perceived. The core beliefs here would be linked to risks, dangerous situations, and uncontrollability. They can differ in all different psychological and psychiatric disorders. Now, there are specific cognitive hypotheses for all disorders. The negative triad in depression would be regarding self, that I am incompetent or unlovable. For others, it would be that people do not care about me. For future, it would be that the future is bleak. In case of anxiety, negative triad for self would include that I am unable to protect myself. Others, the people would be humiliating me. In case of future, it is a matter of time before I am being embarrassed. I am about to be embarrassed. So in that case, the cognitive triad for different psychological disorders are different. Let's see how the model of CBT actually works. In any given event, there is a cognitive appraisal of the event. Corresponding to that appraisal, there is an affective and biological arousal in the system, which leads to behavioral inclination. And following that, maladaptive behavior patterns are seen. Now, a triggering event is there, appraisal is done, bodily sensations are there, behavioral inclination, and then corresponding behavior is seen. Let's take an example. Bill goes to do some task of collection. Now, the cognitive appraisal he has is, I can never do anything. Corresponding to that, he had a body sensation of low energy, disruption of sleep, increased fatigue, which then lead to behavioral inclination of the fact that I don't want to deal with it, it's too stressful to think about it. And the corresponding behavior would be avoidance and withdrawal. Herein, all the three aspects are being affected. That is the thought, behavior, and the act, and the corresponding feeling. Now, the core feelings. Core feelings are the underlying, and they underline and produce the automatic thoughts. These assumptions influence information processing and organize understanding about themselves, others, and the future. These core beliefs remain dormant until activated by stress or negative life events. Categories of core belief would be helplessness, worthlessness, and being unlovable. The core beliefs influence the automatic thoughts. There are many examples of core beliefs. For example, helpless core beliefs would include, I am inadequate, ineffective, incompetent, I can't cope. In several scenarios, it can be, I am powerless, out of control, trapped, I am vulnerable, weak, needy, a victim, likely to be hurt, I'm inferior, or a sense of failure would be there. In case of unlovable core feelings, it could be, I am unlikely, I'm unwanted, I will be rejected or being abandoned, I am undesirable, ugly, unattractive, boring, or having defects, not good enough to be loved by others. Feelings of worthlessness could be, I'm worthless, unacceptable, bad, crazy, broken, nothing, I'm hurt, I'm dangerous, I'm toxic, evil, I don't deserve to live, and so on. What are automatic thoughts? Thoughts that automatically come to mind when a particular situation occurs is called automatic thought. It happens very spontaneously in response to the situation, occurs in shorthand or word or image. The trigger can be slightest, but the whole system can be activated with it. No logic or no logical sequence is required. It's hard to turn off and may be hard to articulate also. Any stressful situation can lead to automatic thought and corresponding negative emotions. This can happen in fraction of seconds. It does not take really much to influence the entire system. So the automatic thoughts are there. It influences the intermediate beliefs, the rules, the attitude, the presumptions, and then activates the core beliefs of an individual. Hence the cognitive distortions. Patient tends to make consistent errors in their thinking. Often there is a systematic negative bias in the cognitive processing of patients suffering from psychological and psychiatric disorders. To help the patients identify the cognitive errors is most likely to be done through CBT. Cognitive distortions, the systematic error in reasoning that leads to faulty assumptions and misconceptions, which are termed as cognitive distortions. Arbitrary inference, it refers to making conclusions without supporting and relevant evidences. This includes thinking of absolute worst scenario and outcomes from most situations. Selective abstraction, it consists of forming conclusions based on an isolation detail of an event. In this process, other information is ignored and the significance of total context is missed. Overgeneralization, it is a process of holding extreme belief on the basis of a single incident and applying them inappropriately to dissimilar events and settings. Magnification and minimization, consisting of perceiving a case or situation in greater or lesser than it truly deserves. Polarization. It is a tendency for individuals to relate external events to themselves, even when there is no basis for making this connection. Polarized thinking would be dividing the events into black and white, the dichotomous type. The mental filters, it includes ignoring the positive aspects mentalizing the awfulness of this situation. Certain other aspects would be labeling and mislabeling. Labeling would involve patrioting one's identity on the basis of imperfections and mistakes made in the past and allowing them to define one's true identity. Now, the cognitive conceptualization. In any situation, the automatic thoughts are activated related to which the physiological feelings and the behavior is activated. Let's take an example. Any partner says, I need time to be with my friend. The corresponding automatic thought is, oh no, he's losing interest, he's going to break up with me. The corresponding physiological aspect is the heart rate increases and lump in the throat is seen. The feeling would be sadness, worry, anger. And the corresponding behavior would be reassurance seeking, withdrawal or crying. Based on childhood experiences, this can be related. Maybe that the parental neglect or criticism was there in childhood, which can serve as the underlying assumption and core belief. I'm flawed in numerous ways, which means I'm not worthy of consistent attention and care. People only care when they want something. The compensatory strategy would be being independent, you will be safe. Watch out, people are careless with you. These can lead to faulty assumptions. Let's take another example. In any situation when somebody is disappointed because of exam results, the automatic thought is, I'm not going to get through this program. I'm not as smart as anybody else. People will discover this and I will be humiliated. The corresponding physiology is that they can have stomach-related issues, dry mouth. The corresponding feelings would be being worried, shameful, disappointed, humiliated. The behavioral change would be use of alcohol, procrastination, not being regular. The related aspect of youth adversity could be parental standards of reinforcement in academic standards. That is high academic standards. Expectation is high. The underlying assumption could be if I don't excel in school, I am total failure. And the compensatory strategy would be work extra hard to offset incompetency. Response to negative thoughts. There are certain examples in which the cognitive distortions can be reasoned. Responding to negative thoughts. Now, how we have to define the situation is completely as per our thought process. If we are able to define the thought process in a clear manner, it will lead to an appropriate cognitive appraisal. If it leads to an appropriate cognitive appraisal, what was going through in our mind and what did the situation mean would be clear to us and we won't end up making mistakes in that. And the cognitive distortion will not be there. So that can be handled with clarity of cognitive appraisal. Evaluating interpretations, evidence for and against the belief should be reviewed very carefully. The alternatives of others' explanation should be reviewed and the implication of the situation of the reaction of the self and others needs to be reviewed fully so that the cognitive appraisal is effective enough. Evaluating negative thoughts. What is the effect of telling myself this thought? What could be the effective way of changing my thinking? What would I tell a friend or a family member if he or she viewed the situation in this way? What can I do now? If we try to reconsider the thought process, we are most likely to reappraise it in a correct manner. For example, a thought log can be very helpful in such situations. We can log the situation, the thought, the corresponding emotions, the rational response, and the related outcome. In any situation, going on vacation would be
asking a colleague to do some work for me. The corresponding thought will be, she says, no, I am not doing a good job. The boss thinks I take too much time off. The corresponding emotion will be anxiety, guilt, and sadness. The rational response will be, I haven't taken a day off in 6 months. We work as a team, so it's also her job to track the sample. The related outcome then will be anxiety 10%, guilt 0%, relief 40%. So the cognitive distortions, if handled properly, can bring about significant change in the related distressing aspects of emotions. The cognitive distortions are involved here are all or nothing, mind reading, fortune telling, and overgeneralizing. In any scenario, if we are able to track the cognitive distortions, then we are able to reframe it, the corresponding outcome will be very different. The basic principles of cognitive therapy would be that cognitions affect behavior and emotions. Cognitions may be made aware of, monitored, and altered. Desired emotional and behavioral changes can be achieved through cognitive. The change in mode states by using cognitive and behavioral strategies can be attained, that is identifying, modifying automatic thoughts and core beliefs, regulating routine and minimizing the avoidances. Emphasis on here and now, preference or concrete examples, that is starting with specific situations, complete thought log, reliance on Socratic questioning, that is asking oneself open-ended questions that are disciplined questioning that can be used to pursue thought in many directions and for many purposes, including to explore complex ideas, to get to the truth of things, to open up issues and problems, to uncover assumptions, to analyze concepts. Empirical approaches to test the beliefs are there. That is challenging the thoughts not based on evidences, cognitive restructuring. These aspects, they promote rapid symptom change. There are certain behavioral interventions which can also affect the distortion part of the thinking, deep retaining, relaxation, behavioral activation, interpersonal effectiveness training, problem solving training, exposure and response prevention, social skill training, graded task assignments. The cognitive interventions would include monitoring the automatic thoughts, teaching imagery techniques, promoting cognitive restructuring, examining alternative evidences, modifying the core beliefs, generating rational alternatives. The cognitive aspects, they identify negative maladaptive thought patterns like bad habits, automatic in nature, how the thought record is done, challenging the thoughts, and how reality testing providing evidences can create rational reinforcement in the irrational thoughts. How the specific statement based on evidences lead to thought disorders, for example, schizophrenia, challenging thoughts remove aversive reaction to the delusions. CBT technique involves certain aspects of behavioral dependence on the disorder. The anxiety disorders can be treated through muscle relaxation, sleep diary, and sleep hygiene recording, social skill training. Depressive symptoms can be taken care by behavioral activation, pleasant event scheduling, sleep diary maintaining, and sleep hygiene. In situations like schizophrenia, social skills, behavioral modification, and token economy are also very useful. Mostly psychologists practice eclectic approach wherein melting the pot of therapies is there, combination of the techniques of different types of therapies into one that will work the best for the client. CBT often serves as a basis for most therapy settings, but their techniques are incorporated, for example, using free association to discover this content and type of negative thoughts. So the eclectic approach is supposed to be the best approach for dealing with the distorted cognitive aspects. The therapy enables the client with necessary skills to modify their behavior in a way that makes it adaptive rather than maladaptive. So the negative cognitions and emotions decrease as the client learns that they can function in a social situation effectively. Application of PBT is seen in almost all the psychiatric and psychological disorders. What is the key to releasing yourself from the emotional prison? By becoming emotionally healthy. Emotionally healthy involves flexibility, seeking alternatives, and unperfectionist vision that relate to perfectionism demanding. People can live the most self-pulling, creative, and emotionally satisfying lives by organizing and disciplining their thinking. Blaming oneself or other is the core of most emotional disturbances. Since we create our own disturbances, thoughts and feelings, we have the power to control our identity. Conclusion. Thoughts create your emotions. Emotions cannot prove that your thoughts are accurate. Remember, the feelings are not the facts. The feelings are the mirror, the way we think. The perception makes no sense, then the feeling they create will be absurd. These abnormal emotions feel just as valid and realistic as the genuine feelings created by distorted thoughts. Learn to avoid painful feelings based on mental distortions, as they are neither valid nor desirable. Once you have learned how to perceive life more realistically, you will experience an enhanced emotional life with a greater appreciation for genuine sadness, which lacks distortion. Thank you.
We can stop sharing?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much. It was a very enlightening session. And there are quite a few questions, and I think all of us who were listening to your session have actually started thinking of what disorders they have. I myself have been calculating which of the disorders that you mentioned I have and how should I use CBT to heal myself. So I'll start with the questions here. The first question is actually from a parent, and I identify a lot with this question. The question is that if there are issues happening with the adolescent, as a parent, what should you do? Should you intervene and soothe the situation? Should you stay away? Should you get directly involved?
No, we need to know the nature of the problem. So knowing the nature of the problem will first demand explanation on the situation, as in what is the scenario, what is the nature of the problem. Once we know in depth the nature of the problem, corresponding to that, only the problem can be solved. So is it in particular area?
Okay. I think the person who's asking the question can consult with you directly for a specific situation.
Yeah, there. Because it differs in every situation. If it is anxiety, is it different? If it is depression, it is different. If it is any other adolescent aspect, it will be different.
In general,
knowing it in detail would be important, and then corresponding to that, you know, it can.
I think a lot of people and faculty who are listening to this session are dealing with the adolescents at home currently in the COVID scenario, when everybody is having online teaching. Exams have either been postponed or cancelled. Some of them were appearing for entrance test and they are at home. So I think that is causing a lot of anxiety in general in adolescents. So what could we as parents do?
The general rule then would be, if we want to help somebody, we need to know one's situation. So we have to be in good talking terms with the child, and a common negotiation, a common pathway of dealing with situation has to be talked out. We can't dictate ki tumko ye karna hai, aise hona chahiye. It has to be a well-discussed, thought-about way of handling the situation. Ki tumko kya pasand hai, tum kya karna comfortable feel karoge, aur kab, aur kaise. The autonomy part has to be with the child, although well-discussed.
Plus scheduling of your
scheduling, although well discussed, but has to be monitored by the parents, but has to be well discussed.
Okay, I think that's a good suggestion.
Can I just make a comment?
Yes, ma'am. Dr. Goodbeat.
Yeah.
It's very close to my heart. Thank you very much for a very good lecture, Dr. Nidhi and Dr. Mamta. As we know that most of the health problems, 50% of the mental health issues start before 14 years of age. And it's not only important to treat, but to prevent. And as most of the children go through us, so we actually give anticipatory guidance to them. And it's very important to give them anticipatory guidance about healthy lifestyle. It's been seen in literature also that if they follow healthy lifestyle and have very healthy parenting, which is called authoritative parenting, it helps to curtail the onset of problems of mental health issues, but also it helps to mitigate the health problems. And since there have been a lot of lifestyle change because of this pandemic, it's very important that we have to give guidance to them that they have to continue to follow the normal discipline of at home. You know, if the child is not going to school, even the sleepy-wake cycle also should remain the same. And also authoritative, that means there are good expectations, but there are good control, but there are good love and affection. And even good parenting, like creating less conflicts at home, acceptance of the child as he is, giving him privacy whenever it's needed. And so keeping a good control would really help. And also we follow a very good screening tool in our adolescent clinic, which is HEDIS. Find out about home, find out about education, their activities, their spirituality, their sports activity. So by that, we actually screen out and whatever problem comes up, like then we can have the specific screening questionnaires. And then we can have a, if the red flags are there, then we have the help of psychologists and psychiatrists. So I would just advise to all parents that they have to set good routines for their children. So that would help too. Thank you.
I think I would like to now move on to some questions from some of our students. And I think it's a very right time that we provide support for them. And I'll just like to mention to the students who are participating in today's Grand Rounds that Dr. Nidhi and Dr. Mamta are available for you whenever you need support. But there's one question which I think I need to take up here, and I'll see, let's see if you can respond to that. Somebody should know, what should we do to stay calm when you are in emotional turmoil? How do you develop a positive attitude? I think it works for all of us. So what do you have to say for that?
It's actually a long-term process wherein I already explained how the dysfunctional thought create the basis for it. If the core beliefs are strong enough and positive enough, you can stay calm. But if the core beliefs are not helping you, if they are negative in nature, the milestones are not good. Since the milestones are not good, the dysfunctional beliefs do take a toll on the entire thought process. So it's not a short fix. If you want to stay calm, you have to work on your thought process completely. If slightest of the trigger is there, it can disrupt the whole thought process. So we have to be very careful that we take care of all the negative thoughts throughout.
So introspection, evaluation of all the situation, and then communication. This is the mainly key of this, you know, staying calm. And at the moment, suppose you are not able to handle the situation, then indulging in some healthy activities like maybe going for walk or maybe going for deep breathing or maybe going for some exercise, and then having right communication with your family members, with your friends. You know, this makes you relax for the situation.
Yeah.
But long-term introspection and having communication and resolving your internal issues is the most important for staying mentally healthy.
Yeah, resolving the issues with self and others.
Yeah.
That is through, as I explained, through the cognitive law also that can be done, the cognitive reappraisal part.
Okay, I think it's easy to talk about this, but I don't think as a person who has mental health issues, it's always very easy to apply what you're saying.
Ma'am, you they need professional help in that case.
Definitely.
They do. But it is something which can be corrected. It's not a lifetime.
And I think the first step towards correction of issues is realizing that you have a problem and accepting that you need help. And one of the reasons why mental health issues are on the rise is people, especially in India, consider mental health issues as something which is a taboo stigma, not to talk about. It's stigma. And I think it's the time to come out in the open and talk about your problems. And there's nothing to feel.
I think dysfunctional beliefs do exist in all of us, literally all of us. Maybe we are able to take care of it because we are aware of it, and the people who are not aware of it they fall prey to certain aspects of mental health.
Yes. So awareness of the situation, awareness of your problem, that actually you having this, you are suffering from this problem, is most important, is more important for going ahead. Suppose you are not aware and you are behaving and you are reacting again and again, then situation will not get solved.
Yes, so taking the responsibility is very important.
Yes, and just for the information of everybody, we do have a student support center. And if any one of you feels that you need to approach, even though we call it a student support center, I'm sure it's open even for faculty members. We are all still kids and adolescents at some times. So with that, I think we'll end today's session. It was very wonderful, especially the discussion that we had on the questions, and both of your responses were really useful. So we'll end the session today. And next Saturday, we have Dr. Jaideep Malhotra. He is a former president of FOXI. We heard about children last time. We heard about adolescents. And next time, we are going to listen about motherhood and how it is going to develop our future generation. So thank you very much. Have a good weekend. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.